This is Washington Boulevard near FTD headquarters in downtown Detroit, Michigan, where more than 2,000 members and guests came in August 1960 to celebrate FTD's 50th birthday. As the first organization to hold a convention within the splendid marble walls of Cobo Hall at the end of Washington Boulevard. FTD members and guests began arriving early Sunday morning to register for the convention. Making their way down the long hallway toward the convention area. The registration booth was a good place to meet and greet friends. In the foreground is Joseph Hines, whom members later elected president of FTD. The registration booth and booths of other FTD facilities made a busy line. FTD field men assisted in the registration. Among them in the foreground, Erwin Hamay, with FTD 18 years, and Simon Weaver, a 15-year veteran. At the registration desk, members, their families, and guests received a book of tickets to convention events, a complete program, a convention gift, convention badge, and FTD button. At the 1960 convention, members also received a free copy of Flowers by Wire, the FTD history. After registration, a popular place was the hospitality room, replica of a French sidewalk cafe, where tall windows gave a view of Windsor, Ontario, across the wide Detroit River. Treasurer Andrew Strang, Director Marshall Gifford, and Public Relations Representative Joe Daly talk, as do Interflora President Jack Shearn from London, former President Marion Fisher, and others. But relaxing was not for unit officers who met late Sunday morning for brunch in the Sheraton-Cadillac Hotel to discuss unit affairs and problems. Vice President Joseph Hines presided over the meeting. He was assisted by President Irving Allen and Secretary and General Manager John L. Baudet, who attended all meetings advising on FTD headquarters affairs and procedures. Introductions from the floor gave unit officers an opportunity to see and know their colleagues from all over the United States and Canada. The friendships formed at conventions not only add to FTD's structure, but give individual members a stronger incentive to exchange orders with members they know personally. A mental delivery directory of florist friends throughout the entire association. There was much enthusiasm around the tables before members paused to hear a talk by FTD parliamentarian Herberta Ann Leonardi on the use of parliamentary procedure at unit meetings. Vice President Hines adjourned the meeting in plenty of time for the International Floral Design Institute, a dazzling high point of the convention. More than 11,000 flowers decorated the International Floral Design Institute. The 64-foot stage was lavishly draped in gold lamé to honor FTD's golden anniversary. Commentators Sylvia Valencia of Westboro, Massachusetts, and Ed Dallas of Chicago worked from a revolving turntable which brought commentator and six designs into view at the same time. Six top American designers and six from Italy, Denmark, Germany, England, France, and Holland worked from early in the morning, each preparing 20 designs for the show, a total of 240 arrangements for the four-hour institute. FTD members sat enthralled by floral beauty as commentators explained the theories of mass and line and color that lay back of each unique arrangement, and the techniques of structure and holding that made such unusual designs possible. The incorporation of the container into the overall design as an integral element of the arrangement, and the integration of characteristic art objects into the design to pinpoint the occasion for which it was made, were other novel points. Veteran member and past director Carl Reck listened attentively. Nowhere else in the world can the FTD member receive such a concentrated course in the theories and techniques of his profession. Books and pictures cannot match the advantages of first-hand instruction and demonstration. The opportunities to hear the authoritative commentation, the chance to observe at close range, to talk personally to the designer. Notebooks were filled with money-making and prestige-building ideas from top American and European designers, like Wayne Andrade of California, Philip Cummins of Tennessee, and Pat Wiley Sullivan of Texas. There was beautiful humor, too, like Pat Sullivan's Model T tribute to Detroit. Major Madeline McGinnis modeled a standard corsage for Air Force women, which was selected at a press conference during the convention. The final 2 hours of the International Floral Design Institute were given over to European designers like H.W. Wienink of Holland, whose halting English brought smiles, but whose brilliant work showed courage and daring, as well as a thorough knowledge of art principles and design possibilities. Standing by was Umberto Formicello, FTD field representative, who speaks 5 languages and who acted as interpreter. Winifred Lane of Teignmouth, England, explains her theory of design and the utilities of the arrangements she has prepared. Albert Urich of Bad Godesberg, Germany, with interpreter Formicello's help, showed the German concept of floral artistry. To the outstanding work of American designers, the European florists added many new notes. They show many instances of imagination and courage, the employment of space as a design integer, allowing a subtle interplay of light and shade in their arrangements. They use reverse color combinations, heavy colors above light, dark reds above light yellows. To a degree, they turned from the traditional art concept of frozen motion to impart instead to their designs a sense of imminent action, almost of movement. And the delighted audience thanked them for the tremendous dividends in enjoyment and instruction their exhibition provided. Following the Design Institute, FTD played host to a 50th anniversary party where friendship and good talk prevailed. Juniors were not forgotten. They had their own pizza party, part of a full convention schedule for children who accompanied their parents to the convention. But some juniors just could not decide how they wanted to pose. On this occasion, FTD held its first public design institute. 8,000 persons attended. Admission to the public was by tickets secured by calling at local FTD member shops. Schoolmaster Henry Forster of Detroit welcomes a capacity crowd. To accommodate all who attended, 2 complete shows were necessary. Many persons had to be turned away for lack of seating room. The design triumphs of the afternoon were repeated for the public. Said one non-member florist who attended, "This is the greatest thing that ever happened to the florist industry." As a fitting and friendly climax to an eventful day, Todos Amigos, the club formed 30 years ago during the famous 1930 convention by train, met to talk a toast of many things, not the least of which was a great opening of a great convention. Next morning, the annual business meeting opened. In these meetings, the financial and business affairs of the association are discussed, possible bylaw changes explained, and the many phases of the operation of a multi-million-dollar business association are considered. General Manager John L. Beaudet and Vice President Joseph Hines stood with Canon Irwin C. Johnson as the blessings of God were invoked upon the meeting. Harold Hutchings of Detroit, Chairman of the Convention Committee, greeted the visitors. Ed Luty, Anniversary Chairman, as part of a special anniversary program, introduced Charles S. Pinnock, President of the Society of American Florists, who extended the congratulations of that organization upon FTD's 50th birthday. The Board of Directors was introduced to the members present. and Director-at-Large Bessie Pawson and Associate Division Chairman O. Ben Haley acknowledged introductions. Past Presidents Ernest Simmons, William E. Joy, Ed McCarthy, H. Rollo Mueller, Granville Goody, James Laurie, Ed Ludwig, Victor Stein, Marion Fisher, Eugene Dardlin, and Stanley C. Minshall were presented with bronze honor plaques in appreciation of their services to FTD. President Allen received his plaque from Chairman Luty. While a quartet sang songs of the past 50 years, Mark Williams, author of Flowers by Wire, recounted the history of FTD. While an artist at a huge graph sketched the growth of the association from its faltering start on August 18, 1910, and even the quartet cheered when the artist had to use a ladder to show the fabulous height of FTD's growth curve. The City of Detroit's official welcome was delivered by Mayor Louis C. Mariani, who praised FTD for the lavish manner in which they had decorated Cobo Hall for its first convention, and congratulated General Manager John L. Baudette, a member of the Mayor's Commercial Development Committee, for the splendid showing. The FTD headquarters staff was resplendent in gold anniversary jackets for its introduction to the members. President Irving Allen received a standing ovation as he rose to begin the first session of FTD's 50th anniversary convention. Outside the busy meeting, electioneering went on for candidates for FTD offices for the coming year. Lou Anderson of New Jersey appreciated the age-old combination of beautiful bells and beautiful blossoms, while others took a musical approach with a south of the border bid for north of the border votes. The Monday midday feature was luncheon in honor of FTD past presidents. This was the first such luncheon held in this magnificent new hall, and the size of the crowd shows the affection which FTD members hold for their past officers. Past President Stanley C. Minshall acted as master of ceremonies. And good food, companionship, and conversation filled the room. Arranged on the president's table were the gavel for authority, the plaque for honor, and flowers for beauty. Authority, honor, and beauty, a fitting tribute to past presidents. Meanwhile, in the Henry and Edsel Ford Auditorium, adjacent to the convention hall, rehearsals went on for the star-studded Bell Telephone Hour spectacular presented by American Telephone and Telegraph in honor of FTD's 50th anniversary. Here are the actors in their working clothes. But when the big hall filled that night and the lavish curtain rose, things looked different. Elaine Malbin, famous Metropolitan Opera soprano. Keith Andes, star of stage, screen, and television. And Mindy Carson, nationally known recording star, sang their way into the hearts of FTD members while a chorus of boys and girls enlivened the proceedings with intricate dance steps. TV viewers who know Keith Andes as the rough and tough Colonel Dawson were surprised at his sprightly dance with a beautiful companion and his rich rendition of Only a Rose. The telephone commercials with Tom Poston, star of TV's To Tell the Truth, and New York stage comic Elliot Reed, and the beauty of former Miss America Marilyn Van Derber, recited the value of the telephone to FTD members. Framed in the spotlight circle, Mindy Carson sings her latest recording, Violets for My Furs. and the beautiful chorus makes a specialty number of Blossoms of Broadway. Notice that while three of the girls threw their flowers to the audience, the fourth refused to part with hers. Lauren Hollander, brilliant 19-year-old pianist, plays a Grieg concerto and graciously acknowledges the support of conductor Don Voorhees of the Bell Telephone Hour, who directed the entire Detroit Symphony Orchestra as the show's accompaniment. Folk music is supplied by the Brothers Four. And Tom Poston here characterizes a florist. A florist is a pillar of strength, yet shy and insecure. Hard working, yet easy going. Hopeful, yet worried. Republican, yet Democrat. And all things to all men. And his two best friends are his flowers and his telephone. For the Basin Street Beat, the Bell Telephone Hour presented the Dukes of Dixieland, a New Orleans combination of rhythm and harmony that brought the music of the Southland to FTD listeners, and also demonstrated some fine footwork by the trombone player. A somewhat wobbly Mercury was a party to an amusing musical argument between Tom Poston and Elliot Reed. The argument involved an equally insecure Bell telephone emblem. With our poor wing-footed fellow finally succumbing to the forces of gravity with as much dignity as he could command. While flashes from FTD members' cameras illuminated the huge Bell system symbol which dominated the stage, girls from the audience carried bouquets to the principal. After the grand finale, the audience filed out into the soft summer night, and there were many expressions of thanks and praise to American Telephone and Telegraph for the wonderful entertainment. Next morning, the business meeting was resumed with serious consideration of the affairs of FTD, and the meeting was thrown open to the members for questions from the floor upon any and all aspects of the FTD operation. These questions were answered both in detail and in depth by President Irving Allen and General Manager John L. Baudette. Explanations on bylaw changes were given, and the suggestions from members expressed on the floor were duly noted for consideration. Field representatives roamed the aisles of the huge hall with microphones. Questions were amplified so that all present might hear them without difficulty, and so that Mr. Allen and Mr. Baudette might answer readily and fully without any time being lost in repetition of the question. Here, Director Robert C. Cherry collects the votes of his region. For purposes of this meeting, members were seated according to their regions and voted by special ballots supplied them upon registration. The trade fair conducted by the Associate Division was an attraction for many during the convention. Open all day, every day, it was a carnival of convenience and color for FTD members wishing to view the latest in suppliers' wares. Children collected souvenirs at the various booths. Or they just enjoyed the exhibits and the amusing antics of outstanding mechanical figures and attractions. there was something interesting for everybody. There were attractions and beauty at every turn. And when feet grew tired from constant walking through the trade fair, it was time for a much-needed rest in the hospitality area, where one could relax in comfort. Ah, solid comfort. But even hospitality must stop somewhere. The line of FTD booths was always busy, with members here being able to buy at the FTD knick-knack counter characteristic FTD jewelry, smocks, calendars, and other supplies. Get information on monitor. Find out more about the convention savings plan, or discuss insurance. And, of course, everyone wanted to get a ticket or a group of tickets to the President's Banquet and Ball, the gala social event of the year. With so much going on, at times things got a little confusing. One of the most impressive sights was the beautiful pyramid constructed by Roses Incorporated, made of 5,000 assorted roses. Sunglasses were the order of the day. And for some, it was FTD all the way. At lunchtime, the Chevrolet company treated FTD ladies to a style show. Beautiful models showed what m'lady will be wearing. Commentation was by Genevieve Haphazard, famous advertising executive who travels the world to secure original styles to be worn by Dinah Shore on the Chevrolet TV shows. This is what Dinah Shore will wear in the forthcoming TV season. Tuesday was election day, the day when the new officers of FTD were to be chosen. Special police kept the area open and directed voters to the polls. Voting credentials were carefully examined and listed by the voting clerks. And the voting was conducted along precise and well-controlled lines. This equipment is the same as that used in national elections, and the votes are automatically tabulated as they are cast. When the polls closed at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and the announcement of the election results was made, it was not hard to pick out the successful presidential candidate. This is Joseph Hines of Chicago, acknowledging the applause of the meeting upon the announcement of his election to the office of president. Hines and Victor Stoll, successful vice presidential candidate, congratulate each other. Vice President Stoll receives a congratulatory kiss from his daughter and one from his wife that simply knocks her hat off. Mrs. Hines offers her congratulations to the new president. And Unit 5, Hines' home unit, stages a victory parade in his honor. Victor Stoll thanks his supporters. Irving Allen and Marion Fisher were nominated to the board of Interflora. While the new president from the podium promised FTD a go, go, go year. Tuesday night brought another theater party when the associate division presented Down Memory Lane, an echo of old vaudeville days, with jugglers, singers, dancers, musicians, and comedians, all wrapped up in a neat package of fun and music as a special tribute to FTD's 50th birthday. From a group that has been a solid section of FTD for many years. To say that a good time was had by all is to put it mildly. And as a fitting climax to a great show, old Ben Haley, chairman of the Associate Division, presented to FTD, through past President Irving Allen, a scroll of congratulations on 50 years of success and progress. On Wednesday, 7 different comprehensive business clinics were held for the information of FTD members. The subjects were credit and collection, telephone selling, artificial flower arranging, selection of a retail shop location, delivery problems, department store flower show promotion, and shop improvement. Here, Stephen P. Dulcimer conducts the clinic on artificial flower arranging. And here, General Manager John L. Baudette serves as moderator of a panel discussion among Esteban Valencia, Edward Geppner, Ralph Bachman, and Harry Miller on the subject of department store flower show promotion. These outstanding FTD members have been responsible for shows at Macy's in New York, Jordan Marsh in Boston, Dayton's in Minneapolis, and Hudson's in Detroit. Juniors kept busy with their own design school, where they receive the highest type of instruction from recognized designers and teachers. The ample supply of stock with which the kids worked allowed them to design within a wide range. And some of the work turned out by these juniors was really of professional quality. Demonstrating a knowledge of design principles and techniques, and what is more important, a love for working with the beauty of flowers. A corsage bar, maintained in the main hall of the convention building throughout the meeting, was a popular feature with members and the public alike. Proceeds from this shop added more than $1,100 to the funds of the Foundation for Future Florists. Many members avail themselves of the opportunity to tour FTD headquarters offices during the convention. They assembled in groups in the main reception area, where guides met them and conducted them through the offices, explaining the functions of the different departments. This is the clearinghouse, the heart of FTD, and the first non-commercial clearinghouse of its type established in business history. It began operation in 1923 on a voluntary basis. Its use by FTD members became mandatory on January 1st, 1924. There is an air of quiet tenseness here, as the busy fingers of the highly trained key punch operators flip over the keys of their machines, punching out thousands of IBM cards daily. These cards are the initial step in the completely automatic processing of members' accounts. The sorter separates incoming and outgoing orders and electronically determines whether to debit or credit a member's account. The collator matches the IBM cards to the member's code number for debit or credit, and also determines whether the report comes from a member in good standing. Clearinghouse manager Frank Carter conducts the group into the heavy equipment section of the clearinghouse and explains the operation of the huge electronic machines which translate the IBM cards into order reports. Here, order reports, automatically printed, pour out of one of the electronic accounting machines. Thursday was a great day for FTD members. Relaxation in the business affairs of the convention gave them time to see some of the sights of Detroit. Early in the morning, huge buses loaded with convention visitors began leaving downtown Detroit for Henry Ford's Greenfield Village, where ancient automobiles paraded through the grounds, and where striped circus tents covered luscious barbecued meals that caused many mouths to water in anticipation, and colorful fruits and salads added the proper touch to a gastronomic treat. Meanwhile, the good ship Suwannee gave passengers a chance to call out, "Steamboat round the bend," in true Mississippi riverboat fashion. Also on Thursday, August 18th, FTD's 50th birthday, an interested group of members, past presidents, and FTD officials met with Detroit Mayor Muriani to lay the cornerstone of the new international headquarters building of FTD and Interflora. A copy of Flowers by Wire, parchment copies of resolutions authorizing the building, and the anniversary issue of FTD News were placed within the cornerstone niche. The initiation was complete of a building that will be as functionally beautiful as any in the world and a fitting recognition of 50 years of growth and progress. The cornerstone was laid in place and the mayor christened it with his official tap. This model gives an excellent idea of the building's final appearance. Two floors will provide 20,000 square feet of air-conditioned office space. The second floor is reached by an open stairway from the two-story high main lobby. The building will be beautifully appointed and landscaped. The crowning event of the convention came when convention chairman Harold Hutchings lit the candles on the huge flowered birthday cake to start the president's banquet and ball. Those who had stood in line to exchange their registration book tickets for reservations to this gala party were certainly not disappointed by this splendid scene. There were two beautifully decorated stages. Strolling musicians added melody to the lights and laughter. And feminine finery blended with beauty and good talk to climax an outstanding convention. Thank you, and a toast to you too, and may we see you next year in Montreal. Yes, in 1961, it's FTD in Montreal, where hospitality and history intermingle in a warm welcome to every visitor, and where you, members of Florist Telegraph Delivery Association, can take another step forward into a future of flowers and fortune.